Good evening. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to South Point. We're glad to have you here in our week of prayer. For those who have been here, it's been a blessing to listen to every night's speech. I would also like to welcome those who are watching us online. Before we start, let's do a little prayer. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for all the blessings that you're giving us. Thank you for the opportunity that you've given us to be here. Please be with Elder David Royce, who's going to have the speech tonight. Let it be to help for us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We're going to sing now hymn number 520. He heedeth my soul.
A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, the shadows of dry, thirsty land. He hideth my love in the depths of his love, and covers me there with his hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord. He taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up, and I shall not be moved. He giveth my strength of my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, the shadows of dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, and covers me with his hand. With numberless blessings each moment he crowns, and filled with his fullness divine. I sing in my rapture, O glory to God, for such a Redeemer as mine. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, the shadows of dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, and covers me there with his hand. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, the shadows of dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, and covers me there with his hand.
Now we're going to have a prayer in twos by Jean Nestor.
Good evening, church. I don't know about you guys, but I have really been enjoying this week of prayer. And God has really been working in my heart and sharing a lot of things with me of how I need to stay focused and how I need to continue and be diligent and be like a new Christian and staying focused in my prayer life. So tonight, as I do the prayers in twos, I thought about the topic. The topic's going to be talking about prayer promises in the Bible. And I found this verse, and I think that's pretty fitting. It's in Romans chapter 4. Let's start with verse 19. And it reads, "And not being weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old." We're talking about Abraham here. "Neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promises of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and believing fully, persuaded that what he had promised, he was able to perform. And therefore, it was imputed to him for righteousness." So Abraham trusted God's promises. And trusting God's promise, it was imputed to him righteousness, as the word of God says. So tonight, I would like for you guys to share with me, and those of you got online also, think about this. Think about what is a promise of God that you hold on to each and every day, especially in those moments that you are really weak, you really need something, and there's nothing to hold on to. What promise of God do you hold on to that helps you through it all? Anybody want to share the promise that they have, David? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Anybody else? George?
By the scripture and by his creation. And just to get, how do I call it? You and I would understand the term, the schmaltzy.
Yeah.
outside of Home Depot this evening or afternoon, I was thinking about things, but I heard this chirping racket in this tree hanging over the car. And you know the song, how he knows about every sparrow. Well, this little fluffy thing was chirping away. And to me, that is a representation, sort of an anchor, that no matter what I'm struggling with my personal beliefs, that God is a God of love.
Oh, God's a God of love. Anybody else?
It's found in Psalms, and it says, "When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I."
Awesome. Lead me to the rock that's on high. I'll share mine. Mine is that God will never leave me nor forsake me. I love that word, and no matter where I am, I know that I am protected because he will never leave me nor forsake me. Anybody else? Okay. So tonight we're going to break up in twos. We've been doing this every night, and I would recommend that you guys find somebody you haven't prayed with yet on and doing our week of prayer. Just find a partner that you haven't prayed with and just pray with them. Pray with them on in with a prayer of thanksgiving for God's promise. Pray with them that others will get to know the Word of God and God's promises and hold on to it, never let go of it. Pray for families. Pray whatever God puts in your heart to pray for. But just find a partner and share and the Word of God. David. Don't look at poor buddy. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight to worship you, Father. This is just not coming to this place to talk about wonderful things. It's about worshiping you. It's about worshiping you because you are worthy of being praised, Father. You are our God, and you have so much promises for us for our lives each and every day. And we thank you for taking the time to prepare all these wonderful promises for us. Father God, I ask that you help us to take these promises to heart, that you may write them on our heart, on the tablet of our hearts, Father, and that we may use them each and every day, every moment of our lives. For those watching online, for those who are here tonight, Father, we pray that we use those promises to bring glory, praise, and honor to everybody we meet, everywhere we are, Father. That we may use those promises and that people may see them just glorify and just represent you in every way, Father, that you may receive every glory that happens with us using those promises, that they may not be about us, but they may be all about you. Father God, we thank you for this service. We thank you for the week of prayer that includes praying for families. We pray for each and every family represented here, each and every family represented online, Father. All that, everyone that's here and those who are not able to be here, all those who are at work tonight, Father, who want to be here, who are their hearts are here, Father, we pray that you may touch them right where they are. Father God, we want to thank you. We want to thank you because you chose us, Father. We didn't choose you, you chose us. Before we were born, before we were conceived, you already prepared this day for us. You already prepared those promises for us. We're not deserving, but you make us deserving because you love us. Father God, we want to thank you for loving us. Thank you for blessing us. Thank you for being with us. Father, I ask that you forgive our sins. You help us to become anew again tonight, Father. That you help us to represent you in everything we do, even the minor things, the little things. You say in your word, it is when we do well in the little things, you will bless us with bigger things. We are taking that promise, Father, tonight. We are receiving it. And we will do better in the little things and grow in weight. Because when you promise something, you always do it, Father. You always come through. Father God, I want to thank you. We ask a blessing for the word that's going to be brought tonight by David Rez, that you may just touch him, Father, that you may speak through him, that you may give us what you prepared for us tonight, that we make it take it to heart. We ask you all these things, Father, in your Son Jesus' name, amen.
So, promises in the Bible. For every situation that we're facing, we can find a promise in the Bible, and we know that the Lord is faithful to his word, and that is going to be the topic of tonight. But before we go into that, Elena Aetonu is going to sing special music to prepare us for tonight's speech.
Just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus said the Lord.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus said the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, all for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just to sing the faith to plant me near the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to come, just from Jesus simply taking and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
I learn to trust him. Gracious Jesus, Savior, more. And I know that thou art with me, will be with me till the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust you, how I love you more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
I'm not usually up front. And I can't say that I'm comfortable being up front, but there's something about having to be up front, having to present, having to teach, that forces you to dig deeper, and there's nothing like it. God has a funny way of getting our attention. I just want to start off with a quick prayer, please. Father, thank you so much for your grace, for your love, for your mercy. We owe you everything. Without you, we are nothing. But Lord, you give us so many opportunities to prove your love, to see your love, to realize it in our lives, and for that we are so grateful. Please, as I step before your people to share a word, I ask that not my words, but your words come through. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Like I said, he has a funny way of getting our attention and teaching us things that he wants us to learn or areas in our life that we need to shed light. And for me, the importance of prayer is one of those areas. We will never learn more than when we are given the responsibility to preach or to teach or to share with others. And perhaps this is why Jesus knew this and said in Matthew 28:19, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in my name, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Jesus knew that if our commission included to go forward and teach, that we would be forced to stay connected. We would be forced to dig deeper. We would be forced to study and show ourselves approved. My prayer life is one area in my walk with God where I really could improve it. Prayer is like the breath of the Christian. So if we are taking shallow breaths, we don't have the energy. We don't have the vitality to go out and work. You know, just imagine if you only can breathe through a straw at work and you did a physical job, you wouldn't get much done. So prayer is like the breath for us. And it's easy to find ourselves in this rushed culture of 24/7 activity, instant gratification, and constant stimulation that it takes going against the grain, against the norms, for us to embrace the Psalm 46:10 philosophy of be still and know that I am God. Today, the topic I'll be sharing is prayer promises in the Bible, and I came across one study that said there's approximately 5,400 promises in God's Word. That's a lot. Promises given to different people or groups in various times for different numerous reasons, some conditional, some not. The one thing that remains consistent throughout all of those promises is that they are given by an all-powerful, an unchanging, and ever-loving God. As we see in Romans 4:21, he's all-powerful, and it says that he, being fully persuaded that he had what he had promised, he is able to perform. And unchanging, we see in Malachi 3:6, where it says, for I am the Lord, I change not. and always loving. It tells us in John 3:16 how God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. By these and many, many other verses within the Bible, we know that we can truly trust and depend on God for everything and in all situations. He gives us promises through many different verses. Like in 1 John 1:19, he promises, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive and purify. In James 1:5, he promises, if you lack wisdom, you should only ask God, who gives generously to all, without finding fault, and it shall be given to you. In Exodus 14:14, he promises, the Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. In Isaiah 40:31, he promises, but those whose hope is in the Lord, they will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. In Psalms 50:15, he promises, call on me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you, and you will honor me. In James 5:14-15, he promises, if anyone among you is sick, let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and to anoint them with oil in my name. And then the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well, and the Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Those are all powerful promises. And I could not recount the many, many promises that God gives us in his Bible. Because of his infinite love and because of our deep need, he has given us countless promises in which he desires for us to want them and to claim them. So my objective tonight will not be to really look at the thousands of promises, but it will be to look and highlight some, what I think are some important concepts in claiming these promises through our diligent seeking. The first concept is, when it comes to prayer promises, one of the verses that really stands out for me, one of the verses I think are keystone to highlighting what a prayer promise is 2 Chronicles 7:14. If everyone could turn in their Bibles or apps to 2 Chronicles 7:14. And just say amen when you have it. All right. It says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. Those are several conditions that God says he will hear, he will forgive, and he will heal. And we take a quick look at those conditions. If my people, what is it to be a person of God? What is that? Just give me some feedback of what your idea of my people is. Children.
Those who obey.
Commandments. Okay.
Guidelines he set for us.
And if they are called by my name, we see in the Bible, what's another word for the or idea for the name of God?
Yahweh, King of Kings, Creator, wonderful.
Another concept for the name of God I see as character. To take on his name means to take on his character. And if we will humble ourselves, I think Jesus gave us one of the greatest examples of being humble. And seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. So those are several of the criteria that 2 Chronicles 7:14 lays out. And God says, if you will do this, then I will hear you from heaven and forgive your sin and you'll heal your land. The concept is, when we come to God in humility and intentionally submit our wills to his way, he promises to hear our calling and to cover our sins and to heal us. There is a particular story that in regards to this concept in the Bible that stood out to me. And in the application of this, we see that God establishes what it means to follow these concepts and what it means to reject these concepts. And that story is found in 2 Chronicles chapter 14 through 16, the story of King Asa. A little background in this account, we see the fulfillment of the promise when the condition is met, and then the withholding of the promise when the condition is neglected. Now, a little background is that in the time preceding King Asa's rule, King Rehoboam, during the latter part of his reign, forsook the law of God and began to introduce idolatry. So by the time King Asa took power, there was some cleanup to do. And the Bible tells us in chapter 14, 2, "And Asa did that which was good in the sight and right in the eyes of the Lord, in his God. For he took away the altars of the strange gods and the high places and break down the images and cut down the groves and commanded Judah to seek the Lord of their God of their fathers and to do the law and the commandment." Here, Asa tried to do what was right in the name of the Lord and turn the people back to God. We read, if you would like to read along with me, I'm going to read just a couple of verses from chapter 15, 2 Chronicles chapter 15, 1 through 4, 12, 15, and 19. So here, "And the Spirit of the Lord God came upon Azariah, the son of Oded, and he went out to meet Asa, and said unto him, Hear ye on me, Asa, and all of Judah and Benjamin, and the Lord is with ye, and be with him. And if ye seek him, he will be found of you. But if you forsake him, he will forsake you. Now, for a long season, Israel had been without the true God, and without a teaching priest, and without law. But when they, in their trouble, did turn unto the Lord God of Israel and sought him, he was found of them." We jump down to verse 12, and it said, "And they entered into a covenant to seek the Lord God of their fathers, and with their heart, all of their hearts and all of their souls." And 15, it says, "And Judah rejoiced at the oath, for they had sworn with all of their heart and sought him with all of their whole desire. And he was found of them, and the Lord gave them rest round about." And 19 gives the detail that there was no more war until about the 35th year of King Asa's reign. You could see, literally see the fulfillment of 2 Chronicles 7:14 as they turned to the Lord. They prayed, they sought him, they turned from their wicked ways. He heard them, he healed them, and gave them peace in their land. However, that peace did not last forever. The promise was based on the condition that if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I would hear them. We read in chapter 16, 2 and 3, and we could see that Asa turned from trusting the Lord to trusting the world for his ally. It reads, "Then Asa brought out silver and gold out of the treasury's house of the Lord and of the king's house. And he sent to Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, that dwell in Damascus, saying to Ben-Hadad, There is a league between me and thee." Contrast that with the verse in chapter 15 and 12, "And they entered into a covenant to seek the Lord of their fathers with all of their heart and all of their soul." Asa, instead of turning to the Lord, turned to the king of Syria. And what did the Lord, and how did the Lord respond in this? I'm going to read chapter 16, 7, 10, and 12 through 13. And here it says, "And then at that time, Hanani, the seer, or the prophet, came to Asa, king of Judah, and said unto him, Because thou hast relied on the king of Syria and not relied on the Lord thy God, therefore the host of the king of Syria escaped out of your hand. Then Asa was wroth with the seer." Verse 10. "Then Asa was wroth with the seer, and he put him in a prison house, for he was enraged with him because of this thing. And Asa oppressed some of the people at the same time." And then in verse 12, "And Asa in the 39th year," so the 39th year of his reign, "he had a disease in his foot, until that disease was exceedingly great. Yet in his disease he sought not the Lord, but to the physicians. And Asa slept with his father, and he died in the 41st year of his reign." I look at that, and it's something that really caught my eye on top of all that Asa did. Instead of seeking to God for his, continuing the covenant with God for his protection, for his blessing, he sought the king of Syria. And then when he made poor decisions, he punished the seer. He punished the prophet. And time again, we see that in the word, where when kings or leaders or people make bad decisions, they turn from God and punish those who are proclaiming God's word. But what really caught my attention also was in verse 13, the Bible says, "Yet in his disease, he sought not the Lord, but to the physicians." That kind of implied, or do you think that God was sitting waiting for that earnest prayer from Asa to send him physical healing? To me, it says, "Yet he, in his disease, he went to doctors and neglected me. My love was right there, ready to be given to him, and he neglected me." And that cost him his life. The next concept I'd like to go over is the prayer of faith. And that's the kind of prayer we wholeheartedly offer or present to God when we see no means or way of deliverance regarding our condition or what we are asking, our petition. In Hebrews 11:6, it teaches this concept. If you could turn to Hebrews 11:6. And it reads, "But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God," and I want to pause right there. And I want to ask you guys, how do we come to God? What's the means that we come to God? Prayer. So when we pray, "For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and he is the rewarder of them that diligently seek him." When we pray, it's not so much we're praying that God deliver exactly what we're asking. Lord, I want a 2017 red, convertible. It's not so much God deliver exactly what we're asking. It's the fact that we trust that he is able to deliver what is best for us, and he is willing to deliver that. God is not only able, but he is willing. Will we trust him? When we come to God, we must have faith that he wants to do it. And what kind of faith? Hebrews 11:1 tells us what that faith is. And it says, "Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen." The next story I'd like to share to highlight that faith is 1 Samuel chapter 1. And that, to me, this story of Hannah, Elkanah, and Penina gives a great example of what that prayer of faith looks like. You all know the story where the husband, Elkanah, had two wives, Hannah, who was barren, who she couldn't produce children, and Penina, who did bore children for Elkanah. And there was an aspect, there's an additional aspect beyond prayer that I think it's worth taking a minute to share. is when I looked up Penina and I looked up the name, it meant a pearl. Think about that. A jewel that starts from an irritation. A sand gets into an oyster, a grain of sand gets into an oyster, and an oyster puts a coating around it, and another coating around it, and another coating around it, until it becomes a jewel. Then when I looked at the Hebrew word for origin for Penina is panna, and that means to turn towards, to bend or incline, not simply to swirl or tilt, but a deliberate alternation of a course, a progression towards a newly declared and desired objective. And I asked myself, Penina, was she an irritant for Hannah? And then I read in 1 Samuel 1, verse 6, and her adversary also provoked her sore, for to make her fret because the Lord had shut her womb. I think that's an irritation. When the Bible says not only that she's an adversary, but she provoked her sore. She was hurting from all of the antagonism that she received from Penina. Do you see the pearl in the making? And then it goes on to say, I want to ask, now, would Hannah have turned to the Lord as earnestly as she did had Penina not been there to poke and prod and taunt her about having children? I don't know if we can answer that, but I want to ask a question to all of us. In our own lives, have we ever had a person, or have we ever come to an impasse or had an adversary or an irritation in our own lives that drove us crazy? I know I could say yes to that. Before we curse that person or that situation, let it drive us crazy, maybe we should seek or have it drive us to our knees in prayer, just like Hannah did. After all, it may be the Lord trying to get our attention to turn us to him and to put our trust in him and enter into a covenant with him and to receive a testimony that could strengthen others. Getting back to the subject of prayer, though, I really thought that was interesting. And Penina's name is that she was an irritation that would cause turning. Let's read 1 Samuel chapter 1, 10 through 18. I'll try to go really quickly if you guys would like to follow along with me. And she was in bitterness of soul and prayed unto the Lord and wept sore. And she vowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if thou will indeed look to the affliction of thine handmaid and remember me and not forget thine handmaid, but will give into thine hand, give to thine handmaid a man child, then I will give him to the Lord. And all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head. Jump to verse 13. Now Hannah, she spake in her heart, and only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli, the priest at the temple, saw and thought she was drunk. And Eli said unto her, how wilt thou be drunken? Put away the wine from thee. And Hannah answered and said, no, my lord, I am a woman of a sorrowful spirit. I have drunk no wine, neither hard drink or strong drink, but I have poured out my soul before the Lord. And jumping to 17, and then Eli answered and said, go in peace, and the God of Israel grant thee thy petition that thou askest of him. And she said, let thine handmaid find grace in thy sight. So the woman went her way and did eat, and her countenance was no more sad. Think about that faith. All the doctors, all the medicine points to you not being able to have a child. And you plead earnestly to God, and The priest gives you a word. God gives you a word to the priest. Your prayer is answered. Right away, she didn't say, oh, how's that going to be? Or, you know, am I going to supposed to feel something? She right away stood up and said, thank you. She accepted that with faith and went, and her countenance from there was changed. Then the Bible says, goes on to say that they went home, and Elkanah knew his wife, and they had a baby boy. And just as God had promised, she bare a man-child, and just as she had promised in her covenant, she gave that boy, Samuel, to the Lord for service. In these two accounts that I've shared with you guys, we can see that in the Bible, God provides us with examples, and not just in these two. There are many stories in the Bible that God gives us examples on how to claim the promises that he has given to us. In these two, I boil it down to, we must turn to him. We cannot depend on our friends. We cannot depend on the ally of the world. We cannot depend on a president. We cannot even depend on a significant other at times. They are struggling too, but we turn to God. We desire his character. Number two, simply stated, we are willing to submit and obey. His character is found in his law. His character is found in his love. He loves us, and if we are willing to submit to him, and he will grant what is best for us. Number three, to seek him, seek his face, to get down on our knees and pray, to slow down from this 24/7 hustle that we have in our society, and to seek, to set out a time to seek him, to talk to him, to share with him. And then have faith that he is not only able, but willing to deliver, willing to provide, willing to answer. These simple steps are the keys to unlocking the thousands of promises that are in here. There is a promise for every situation we can find ourselves in. Every situation. A friend of mine said, if you take a concordance and search a topic that you're struggling with, whether it's lust, whether it's lying, whether it's a shortfall, meaning you don't have enough money, you take a concordance and you look up a word around that topic, you will find a promise. You will find something that God encourages you. Deliverance is in here. I just want to share a quick testimony that when we earnestly pray, there are times that we won't know what to pray for. We don't even know what to ask for. God will give it to us. When Esther and I were leaving Texas, coming to Jacksonville, I was praying about finding a job. He opened up the door and I got a job. They did not give a relocation expense, and I was at the point in my business, I didn't have a lot of money saved away. I didn't have any money saved away. And when I spoke with the company, asked if they do relocation, they said, no, that's not our practice. And I said, well, that would be very helpful, but I understand. But we'll move forward. Either way, I still want the job. And a couple weeks later, they called back. The process took several months. And believe me, there was lots of prayer and fasting in those months. They called several weeks later and said, you know what? I know it's not normal for us, but we're going to give you a $7,000 relocation stipend. And with that, I was able to make the move. But even with that, we had to pack up our house, get all the stuff into a truck, and drive down to Jacksonville. We didn't have money for gas. And honestly, I didn't even know to pray to ask for gas. It was just, one of those things. And my neighbor, who we get along with, and we talk all the time, he came over and invited us to dinner. We had packed up all of our pots and our fridge, and we had nothing left to eat. And he said, come have dinner with us. And while we're having dinner, he ran out and didn't say anything, and then came back and handed me a check for an envelope with $500. Amen. God is good. I want to share this, a quote that I got from the Morning and Evening Daily Reading, 3rd edition. And it states, "It is interesting to remark how large a portion of the sacred writ, that is occupied with the subject of prayer, either in furnishing examples, enforcing precepts, or pronouncing promises. We scarcely open the Bible before we read, 'Then began men to call upon the name of the Lord.' And just as we're about to close the volume, the amen of an earnest supplication meets our ear. Instances are plentiful. Here we see a wrestling Jacob. There we see Daniel, who prayed 3 times a day, and a David who fell with all of his heart on his knees praying to his God. On the mountain, we see Elijah. In the dungeon, we see Paul and Silas. We have multitudes of commands and myriads of promises. What doth this teach us but the sacred importance and necessity of prayer? We may be certain that whatever God has made prominent in his word, he is intended to be conspicuous in our lives. If he said that much about prayer, it's because he knows that we need much of it. So deep are our necessities that until we get to heaven, we must not cease to pray. Dost thou want nothing? Then I fear, dost thou not know thy poverty? Then I fear thou dost not know thy poverty. Hast thou no mercy to ask of God? Then may the Lord's mercy show thee thy misery. A prayerless soul is a Christless soul. The prayer is a lisping of the believing infant, the shout of the fighting believer, the requiem of a dying saint falling asleep in Jesus. It is the breath, the watchword, the comfort, the strength, and the honor of the Christian. If thou be a child of God, thou wilt seek thy Father's face and live in thy Father's love. Pray that this year thou mayest be holy, humble, zealous, and patient. Have closer communion with Christ and enter oftener into the banqueting house of his love. Pray that thou mayest be an example and a blessing to others, and that thou mayest live more to the glory of thy master. The motto of this year must be continue in prayer." Thank you, saints.
Is it on? Thank you very much, David. We can give David another round of, another amen, I should say. I was going to say another round of applause. He can get a round of applause, too. I tell you, I could have sat in my seat another hour listening to you. It is a blessing to hear you share your heart and your story. And you moved me, and I'm sure you moved those who are listening and those online. And I really want to say to us and those online, all the messages that you hear this week, they're on the website or our YouTube channel. You can go and press repeat, 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 pause, and repeat again, just to hear it at your own pace so you can get into your heart every word that's necessary to keep us in the rightful place of a prayerful heart to connect with Christ. And as I close out this evening, there are a few things that we've been doing all week, and I want to make sure you were listening. Now, David gave 2 of my favorite promises. One was found in Exodus, and there's a book on the chair waiting for you. If you can tell me, where is the promise found that says, "The Lord will fight for you"? 14 what? I need a chapter on the, huh? 14. Very good.
All right, so which one would you like?
All right. So whenever you hear me pray, you will always hear me refer to that at times because I realize I'm a little person and I can't fight. And I know the fight that I have to face is not against human beings, but it's against principalities and things in dark places. And I can't do that. God has to do that for me. So when I call on God, he is going to go out there with swords and everything needed to win the battle for me and for you. So make sure you get that verse and repeat it and get it in your heart. Hide it in there because you're going to need it. Believe me, you're going to need it one day. There's another one in Isaiah 40, 31. Who can repeat Isaiah 40, 31? I'll give you a hint. Those that wait. Come on. All right, just for your effort. Isaiah 40:31. Those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. I love eagles. I love birds. They just connect me with Christ. I'm so excited. David, I'm definitely going to replay that message. It's all the nuggets, and there were so many. I started to write, and I said to myself, why are you writing? You can go online. Okay. So last night in the sermon, Elder Cliff and Elder Flo made reference to the book, The Adventist Home. And our sister Carol, she was watching and she texted me the link. There's a free access to The Adventist Home. So if you don't have it in your home, it's also on the website, the South Point Seventh-day Adventist Church website. It's free. You can go there. You can get information for your worship in your home. And as I mentioned, if you're missing a night, you can go online. It's ready to be downloaded. Also, tomorrow night, we will have Elder O'Neill Catnell. He will be speaking on praying individually or with a partner. So if you are not here, you will be missed. But I want you to come, and I want you to bring somebody with you. Don't just come by yourself. And if whoever you're inviting, if they can't make it, give them the link so that they can go online. And for this weekend coming up, I want us all to start preparing now. We will have an anointing service. And what an anointing service is, and David referred to it in his sermon, it's found in James, where if you are physically sick or spiritually sick, is an appointed time for the elders and the pastors to pray over you and anoint you with oil. And with that prayer and with that blessing, wonderful things can happen. So come prepare for that. Those online, if you are able to come, we would love to have you. It's starting at 6:30. All our services this week begin at 6:30. Just want to make sure I'm covering everything. All right? There is refreshments that's still there for us to partake of. But before we do, let us all stand and let's close out. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for bringing us here safely. We want to thank you for your word. We want to thank you for the song. We want to thank you for friendship. We want to thank you, Father, that there's a safe place that we can come and worship you. Guide us and protect us and take us home safely and bring us back together again. And may we rest in your arms with all the promises that you've put in your word for us. Into your hands we commit everything. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a good night, and we'll see you tomorrow.